preponderance of serials that we were getting in Malayalam Asianet right there in Trivandrum as university students. So we have done that, but that's just a passing observation. I think you're absolutely right when, you know, the public intellectual's role is taken over by people who sustain themselves in these kind of bubbles. Because I just want to mention one, you know, let's say a viral topic right now, which is about the name change of a college. Dayal Singh Evening College has been given this accordance to become a morning college. And a dim-witted chairperson from the BJP proposed a name, and that is now a major topic of discussion, at least as of today. The name is Vande Mataram. Okay, now I'm from that college, but my point is the whole debate was about bifurcation of the college into two morning colleges in the same premises. We have 11 acres of land in Lodi Road, right next to your IAC, our IAC and IHC and whatever it is. But then, you know, for 9,000 students, it's the biggest college, you know, there are no resources. We are not getting any slice of, you know, these aspects in the current debate. Of course, Times Now is leading the campaign saying that, you know, Vande Mataram College is opposed by leftists. So we live in that kind of a situation. Yeah. And I think that, I want all of us, I was just thinking about this possibility of patriotism as the answer to nationalism. Maybe internationalism is the answer. Maybe something else.
I was using those terms rather consciously because nationalism has implicit in it a sense of authoritarian aggrandizement. It's non-federal in its impulse. It demands that you dilute issues of dissent in the larger national cause. In other words, it has a homogenizing influence. And in a country like India, it can be even more dangerous than in Europe and Germany, where it wreaked the havoc it did. And as far as, you know,
the etymology,
nationalism and nation state as a concept has been intellectually discussed. I mean, Benedict Anderson and others have spoken about this imagined community and so on. I'm not even going into all of that. But let me just extend this a little more and be a little more brash, if you like. Who are these people who tell us about nationalism? I mean, these people who were hiding away when India was struggling for its independence. You know, these people who would not raise the national flag in the RSS headquarters until relatively recently, they are the last people who should be uttering the word nationalism. So it's ironic. I mean, it's pathetically ironic. And why should we listen to what definitions of nationalism from these people who have betrayed nationalism when it mattered? Even if you go by the term nationalism.
How can we establish an independent media?
It's an interesting but very difficult question. I mean, alternative media, I think, is already happening in many ways. I think the social media, there are brave attempts at alternative media. Some of it is very interesting. And as I said, some of the mainstream media is actually picking up cues from that. I think blogs are important to media these days. I think media, one shouldn't think of media in the structured, formal sense anymore. A blog is a media, a portal maintained by some group is a media. You know, it's a continuing process. It's a kind of evolving process. It's work in progress, actually. As I speak, there are so many people who are going out there and doing different kinds of media. But the problem is this whole terra incognita of cyberspace. The nature of cyberspace is that it's only where the lit, you know, where the traffic, the footfalls and traffic take place, where there's light. So Google has captured almost all of that, and we all work in the penumbra of Google. In that space to have alternative media. But I think eventually one will find that what makes meaning and what makes a difference, transformative journalism of the kind we speak about, is happening there. And that's the only hope. In fact, the role of digital capitalism in appropriating the media, just as big corporates have taken over in Indian media and internationally, digital, the biggest journalism exercise in the world today, the media exercise in the world today, is Google. And, you know, we're all pale shadows working under this whole illumination called the sun called Google. So that becomes a problem. So there are structural problems, strong structural problems there. So I think little time, time probably will make more change than reason in some cases.
My name is Narayan, myself is a journalist. One of the questions, I just wanted to take this question to another level, in the sense that you have seen the evolution of media, especially TV in India. Now we are living in a time where this can be broadcast. You had to go to Singapore to do the live for the first election coverage. Now we can do the live from here.
Yeah.
So this is a huge potential in terms of technology, if you adopt that in a proper way. Where do you see the future?
Absolutely. So the liberating potential of technology, of the democratizing potential of technology is there, because technology is accessible, it's affordable, it's easy to use. There are no entry barriers into the cyberspace. But as I said, because eyeballs are glued to the place that is well lit, so we are all working in the penumbra of these digital properties, which are the big showcase properties. That's the main problem. So you have to, even if you want to do a video, you have to go on to YouTube, right? But YouTube kicks off its own own kind of perpetuation syndrome, which has strong economic implications. I'm not therefore saying you can cut loose, that would be very idealistic. But the fact that, so it's a usually structural imbalance is inbuilt into it in such a strong manner that it becomes a problematic. But at the periphery, it makes a difference. On the margins, it makes a difference. And in a digital realm, where we traditionally say there's no difference between the margin and the center, because the margins are moving into the center, these are the ways, because of that impact land. I think that affords a huge promise or a huge potential of what can happen in the future. That's all I can foresee at this point of time. Technology is very important, but how many people are looking at it? You can put anything out there, but how many people are able to look at it? How many likes or dislikes? How many people are actually there? How many minutes do they spend on it? That is the whole issue.
Do you think that the left or the parties or the organizations are a little reluctant to adapt this technological possibilities?
I think so. I thought so. But I think now the left is becoming very aware of the need for digital technology and for moving into technology in a big way. But it's true that they should have been them much earlier, because they had the intellectual resource. They had, perhaps you can blame the left, the organized left, for being not waking to its dangers and its potential both earlier than this. We are now in a reactive mode. In the Indian context, it looks like the digital technology in the whole cyberspace is actually being used mainly by the right elements of the right, by the BJP, RSS and their affiliates, and the others are on a reactive mode. You're kind of reacting to that. That shouldn't have happened if we were on top of the technology and understood its potential long before they did.
I have one more question. Myself as a lawyer. Because I've been interacting with a lot of journalists. Why we can't have a public corporation or a big cooperative society of trust by the journalists, owned by journalists, and have a media house? Why that is not successful in India?
it's difficult because of this. The whole game is still largely advertisement dependent. If you move into a subscription model, as all media depends on either advertising or subscription. Subscription being the newspaper, the tower price of the newspaper. If it's a channel on the pay, the pay channels or subscription models. But when the dominant media model is advertisement revenue, you can set up a channel, you can start one. It's not difficult to do that. But how will you sustain it in terms of revenue? How will you give the salaries that people expect? How will you, so this is the whole problem. Sustaining it is a problem.
The question is, how can you criticize the mainstream media? They are into the same business.
They are into the same thing, that's what I'm saying. But if the public interest is not their concern, then let them declare that we are not bothered, we are just a product of the market. I have no quarrel with them. Somebody who says, I'm selling soap in this company, I'm selling media in this company. You treat both equally, then there's no problem.
The talk of cyberspace as an equal playing field, but I'm giving you a concrete example, like Siasat, a Hyderabad-based newspaper. They had, 6 months ago, they were having about 15 lakh plus hits. And it has been very consistently reduced to 5 lakhs, removing them from the Google search. And also, in fact, the editor got a call from Google saying that, you know, why are you publishing anti-national stuff on your website, which is dissent, which is just decided. So while it looks, I mean, in the earlier governments, I don't think this kind of control was there. So if siyasat can be downsized like that, then what about the smaller players? Then we have seen what has happened to Wire recently.
Yeah, that's true. This is a structural imbalance. And big players like Google, I mean, we know where their interests lie. Ultimately, they are the multinational corporations of today. They are the digital capitalists of today.
Facebook also.
And, you know, the other parties and others look like people before them. So, you know, they are huge. So, it's that you're up against. And so I think, though, the way to do this is to really go against the current. Actually, to go against the current. Not to fall for any aspects of this paradigm. If you fall for aspects of the paradigm, the GRP ratings, if you subconsciously, shall we say, internalize the rating syndrome, then you can't come up with an alternative media. Because an alternative media can't be dependent on ratings. But unfortunately, rating syndrome is not there, not only in the media. This is how the public sphere is also subject to rating syndrome. If you go to a bookshop, there's top 100 books. Who has decided the top 100 books? I don't know whether no writing beyond that. Go to music shop, top 10 music. Now, who is doing this? So there is this whole ratings, you know, mindset that has come into society. And the media is, of course, a peculiar expression of that, an acutely peculiar expression of that. Whereas 100 years back, or even less, the biggest achievements in civilization were done because we went against the grain of the popular. This whole populism and the ratings mindset is a problem. I mean, because when everyone was saying the earth is flat, somebody came and said it's round, and the fellow was burnt at the stake first. And then finally somebody said, okay, it makes sense. And so on. So, whether in philosophy or science or mathematics, you go against the grain of the popular. Now, it's all the populism and ratings. So these are at a premium, and therefore demagoguery rather than democracy.
As we are seriously discussing about the possibility of alternative media and the role the left can play in that, how do you evaluate the attempt made by the mainstream left by forming its own television channels at one point of time, which provoked much criticism from certain quarters, saying that it's a right-wing deviation or it's running behind the capital? Now looking back, do you think it was a good step, or do you think that it has been become equally satisfied as the other monopolistic media is, or do you think that it was a good experience?
I'm not going to answer that question directly because I'm not going to say whether you're talking about the Kairali channel problem, whether it's a useful intervention or whether it's and so on. I think if the margins it's useful. It could certainly be better. But I don't think there's a problem. I see no problem with the left getting into the media sphere, into the public sphere. Because if you are in the process of fighting elections in a democracy, you need to influence that democracy. You know, you either participate in the democratic process and contest in the democratic process, which is what you've chosen to do at one level. Then you need to use all the instruments that are available to you to give your opponents a good fight and to see yourself off in a better state there. Otherwise, you should either do that or go to the jungles and take the gun and fight. But you've chosen to participate in the democratic process, which is why I'm impatient with the left's hedging on looking so closely with a microscope on whether this is fascism or not. And also hedging on whether we can actually have an alliance with other forces in order to fight the BJP. It really is beyond me. I'm not able to understand this. I've asked friends who understand left thinking better than me, but they've also not been able to understand.
So, you have been a practitioner of media for last maybe 45 years, I think. So, there was this, after emergency especially, there was this feeling that people who get into media are somebody who thinks it's a public profession, a little socially committed to something good for the society. And you run a Asian College of Journalism.
Yeah.
What is the kind of people? Any profession is as good as the people who practices it, whether it is lawyers or media or anything. So how, what is the evolution which has happened, and can you comment on it? Because that will be interesting for everybody.
Is there any student of ACJ here?
Oh. Yeah, I should be careful.
You shouldn't be.
So, as in DCJ, we make a... Past,
we have to distinguish between past
student and past student. Yes. I think the DCJ curriculum is very, very strongly, I think, inclusive, it's progressive. You make no bones of the fact that they're a progressive college. In fact, nobody from the right comes to speak at a college, even if you invite them. I once called Mr. Gurumurthy to come. He said, why would I come? That's a left college. So, you know, nobody comes. Joe wouldn't come. Although I know him, you know, as a friend, I know Joe used to be a friend actually, but he never come and speak at the college. So, we are progressive. We are, I think, broadly left. We look at issues. We have a compulsory course on covering deprivation, which is really looking at ruralness of India. Is all this very of practical use for the journalists, for our students, for the alumni who pass out immediately? Perhaps not. But I think it's there somewhere. And they create those spaces where they work. The media is not an overdetermined kind of organism where you can't do anything. You can find spaces. And I think the students who make, I think any Dalit writing that's happening in the media today is because of students from ACJ. Almost exclusively because of students. So I think that
it's in English.
Because we are an English medium institute, that's true. We don't care. You're right. The bigger role and the bigger story is unraveling, the bigger narrative is original language media. But there we are not able to make any difference. But English has the unfortunate position of being a greater influencer than some of these regional languages. So I think that's the difference it makes. So I think with time and with a lot of younger people getting out there, I think you need to question journalism. You know, a journalist who doesn't question journalism is not worth his salt. I mean, he's not practicing a profession that's worth his salt.
Should we quit speaking truth to power and concentrate on speaking truth to people? Because that's what matters. What got Gauri Lankesh killed was not speaking truth to power, but speaking truth to people, and that too in the vernacular. And you don't see English language journalists getting killed. And is it the manifestation of this particular thing? When you speak truth to people, it's much more dangerous, and especially in the vernacular.
Yeah.
Did you really see?
Yeah, that's a good point. I think so. It's true that when you become more activist in some sense, and you get directly to speaking to people. There are those who will argue that that's not the role of a journalist. Journalists should confine themselves to the medium that they are working in professionally. I would say that it depends, because when a situation demands that you need to take it beyond your office and beyond your desk, you need to do that. So certainly they are far more vulnerable in the regional language, in the vernacular, if you like. I don't like the term vernacular, because it has a kind of stigma attached to it. So it's only a term for regional language media. That's true. Gauri Lankesh is an example of that. So, but in the English media, you still have this benefit of the club syndrome, and you still you can argue like this, and then go and have a drink with somebody from the BJP in the club after this. So.
One more, I'm sorry, the information, one more dangerous aspect is which is happening in the digital media,
yeah,
which has some, I'm sure some of the digital media. The content management system, CMS, like SquidType, is owned by Raghavmel. And SquidType is taking stakes in all small startup medias, and we can see that all these stakes are sold to one person in future. So eventually, all those small medias which are started with a good objective are ending up in the kitty of someone else. That is which is going to happen in the digital media. Yeah.
Monopolization, this whole oligopoly, cartelization of the media, it began in the 90s, and I think it's become more accentuated. The acquisitions and mergers in the first half of the 90s, the process started and become far more acute now with the 21st century. Right. Thank you very much.